The blackness. Keep on. Amen, amen. Thank you for that ministry of music. Let us bow our heads and go to God in prayer. Faithful God, prayer hearing and prayer answering God. God of creation, God who made everything out of nothing. You said if your people were called by your name, would humble themselves and seek your face, you will heal their land. Well, God, our land needs healing in a way that I don't think it's ever needed healing before. And your spirit in us cries out, Abba, Father, signifying that we are your children. We're seeking your face, not the face of the economy, not the face of scientists or politicians. We are seeking your face, oh God, to heal this land. Heal it spiritually. Heal it emotionally, heal it physically, because the sick need your touch. The poor need healing, the mentally troubled need your presence. Those who claim to be followers of your son, but their actions speak otherwise, they need deliverance. God, I know you can do it. And we are expecting you to bring about change that will have everyone feel your presence. And know beyond a doubt that you are bringing the healing to this land. So until deliverance comes, God, we pray for strength to hold on to your unchanging hand. Give us perseverance to steady our course. Give us victory right now in the midst of any storm we may be dealing with in our life. For in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. And bless God. Again, thank you. Thank you for tuning in once again and being in worship with us. We begin the seventh chapter of Paul's letter to the Roman church this morning. And Romans 7 verse 1 reads as follows. Do you not know, brothers, for I am speaking to men who know the law. And the law has authority over man as long as he lives. For example, by law, a married woman is bound to her husband as long as he is alive. But if her husband dies, she is released from the law of marriage. So then if she marries another man while her husband is still alive, she is called an adulteress. But if her husband dies, she is released from that law and is not an adulteress, even though she marries another man. So my brothers, you also died to the law through the body of Christ, that you might belong to another, to him who raised you from the dead, in order that we may bear fruit to God. But when we were controlled by the sinful nature, the sinful passions aroused by the law, we were at work in our bodies so that we bore the fruit of death. But now by dying to what was once bound us, we have been released from the law so that we serve in a new way of the Spirit, and not in the old way of the written code. So this morning, as we begin this chapter 7, I want to use for a subject today, divorcing the law. Divorcing the law. And I know sometimes it's down in the body of the sermon, but I want to start off today with our quarantine thought, so it could be in your mind as we go through what is before us today. So quarantine thought for today, if I know the law can't save me, why do at times Why do I at times waffle back into a works righteousness lifestyle? If I know the law can't save me, why do I at times waffle back into a works righteousness lifestyle? You know, saying things like, I've done my good deed for today, and acting as if I do enough good, I will balance out sin. Oh, let me run to church, or let me read a scripture, let me quote a scripture, or even pray. Now, these are great things that Christians should always do, but when our purpose in doing them is to erase sinful behavior, or just to ease our own conscience, we're just going through the motions and we're not really doing anything. We fail and fail miserably at trying to erase our own sin with good deeds. When we act this way, we act as if God is in heaven with balance scales next to the throne, moving weights back and forth. And if my good outweighs my bad, then I have the favor of God. Then I will achieve heaven. This is the trick of the law. And living with this mindset never allows us to freely receive and fully receive the grace of God. Receive totally of what Jesus' death on the cross really, really means to us. With this mindset, we continue to take Jesus off the cross and place ourselves on the cross, saying, it is my sacrifice then that achieves my salvation. And by doing that, we continually live in the bondage of the law. Well, today, I will try to even further shed some light on this futile effort of trying to be justified by the law, yet desiring the grace of God. Someone had to die in order to liberate us from the law. And the only person who could do that, the only sinless person who have walked this earth, was our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus then took the penalty and punishment of the law for all sins when he died on the cross for us. Now our risen Savior shares his death and resurrection with everyone who puts their trust in him. This is the reality of the gospel message that many struggle with to receive, because we want to do something in order to participate in or earn our salvation. But again, with Jesus' horrible death on the cross, we're either going to receive all or none of it. It's our choice. In our wanting to help our own salvation, we're actually rejecting God's gift of free grace. We reject the cross and we stay bound to the law and the penalty of the law. Why? Since we are not perfect. Because if we continue this, then we will be condemned and separated from God. So in continuing to drive this point home, Paul has been making since chapter 1. He uses an example that the hearers of his letter would have been very familiar with. He uses an example of marriage. Paul says to be released from the bonds of marriage, one of the parties must die. Hence, the marriage vows are till death do us part. This is important to us because we were born bound by the law, or bound to the law, subject to the law. And until there is a death to free us from the law, we are still bound and subject to the penalty of the law, which says the wages of sin is death. That's one sin, a million sins, death. So in order for us to be released from the law, a death was needed. And that was the sacrificial death of Jesus Christ. Christ died to honor and fulfill the requirements and the perfection of the law. So the wages of our sin is paid with Christ's death. That was his part. Now, the other part is we're still under the bounds of the law until we accept Christ's death as our payment for our own sin debt. Now, what does that mean? Well, we're still bound, or will I say married, to the law until there is a divorce. Yes. And the way we divorce the law is to accept Jesus's hand in marriage. And that we are bound by and then we are bound by grace, the new covenant sealed with the blood of Jesus. To say, Jesus, you know what? I believe in my heart and confess with my mouth that you lived for me, that you paid for my divorce from the law with your life. And through your resurrection, I have a new life with you, not bound or married to the law any longer. And by accepting Jesus' hand in marriage, I am divorced from the law. Jesus is my Savior. Jesus is my Lord. And now I live to please him. Now I live to praise him. Now I live to promote him. Too many people are still married to the law, yet trying to date Jesus. And this dating Jesus life may have moments of light or happiness, trying to draw us to a deeper relationship with Jesus. But what our reality is in a dating Jesus lifestyle is a life riddled with complaining. No joy, no hope, no peace, no protection, no provision. Why? Because we're still married to the law. Listen, we can't have husband expectations for Jesus, the boyfriend, still married to the law. We can't expect to move into Jesus's house, still maintaining residence with the law. A testimony, if you would, of the rewards enjoyed by being married to Jesus, that only happens when there is a divorce from the law. I see people constantly trying to make the law do what it was never intended to do. We say to the law, you know what, law, you never compliment me. I've done all these things to make myself better. Why can't you make me feel good about myself? And the law says, you know what, that's not my job. And what you did to get yourself better, it wasn't perfect, so it's not acceptable to me. The law says you are as much of a failure as you've always been. And I told you the same thing last month when you asked me, and I'll tell you the same thing next month. And I don't know why you keep asking me, because my story never changes. And if you're looking for someone to make you feel good about yourself, then why don't you go to Jesus? Because I don't have nothing for you but condemnation. And if you don't like that, you can get out. You can leave at any time. And we clearly hear what the Lord said, what the law says. But for some reason, we hear it, but our response is different. We think now, okay, it's a personal challenge to make the law build me up, to make the law save me. It's a personal challenge now to make the law love me. And we get all Jennifer Holiday with the law, and we look at the law, and we and I'm telling you, I'm not going. And we say, we look at the law, and we say, and you gonna love me? Really? We begin this quest to make the law love us and save us and redeem us. And we want the law to validate us and build us up. And we try to do all of these things, and we're doing good deeds. And we're mentoring, and we're volunteering, and we're acting nice to people. We're being tutors, and we donate money. We even join a church, and we become a great humanitarian. And we receive all of the accolades and awards for our community work. And we go back to present ourselves to the law. And we say, law, look at all of this stuff. What about now? How do you like me now, law? Look at these things that I've done. Look at these things I've achieved. I've really changed, and I'm a better person now. What say you now, law? And the law says you're just as trifling as you were before you did all of that. And I only accept perfection. And guess what? You're far from perfect. And all of that stuff means nothing with all of the hard work and accolades and all these things that you've done. All you have done is make this world a better place to go to hell from. And the law says maybe one day you'll get it. That a life with me is going to be a life of you're never going to be good enough for me. No compliments come from me, and I will continually point out every flaw, every shortcoming, every failure, every time you fall, I'm going to point it out because that's what I was created to do. And don't you know that by now? Haven't you been listening to your pastor since chapter one? He's been telling you what I'm about. He's been telling you what my role is in your life. He's been telling you that I'm not marriage material, yet you're still here. My purpose is to condemn sin, to judge sin, and I can only be satisfied with perfection. And guess what? I don't grade on the curve. It's either 100 or 0. And there's no need to complain about it. There's no need to talk about how I do what I do. Don't complain about who I am when you have been told, you've witnessed it, and you choose to stay. The door is open. Leave. I can't make you stay. And you can't make me love you, save you, or rescue you. The law says, so do you. Because I'm going to do me. And with that, those who realize that they're in an abusive relationship with the law have a choice to make. And I hope that this has given us a reality that those, especially the Jews that Paul was speaking to, who continue to strive to be justified by the law and doing stuff, that their efforts are worthless because that's not the function of the law. And Paul says to the hearers of his letter, calling them brothers. So he says, this is not you, because you all have made a decision to divorce the law. You've made a decision not to stay in an abusive relationship trying to be justified by the law with no hope. You didn't even pack a bag. You just walked out. Congratulations, saying I've refused to live another minute in this relationship, and you divorce the law and you receive the salvation of Christ, the Lordship of Jesus, and have a testimony of deliverance from an impossible situation to a newness of life now where everything is possible. You know, when I needed my tears wiped away, the law said, too bad. But now God promises to wipe every tear from my eyes. When I told the law that I was worried, the law said, well, you should be. But now Jesus says to me that there's no need to worry. I take care of the birds of the air, and my bride will have nothing to worry about. When I said to the law that I was hungry, the law said to me, well, you might as well starve. But my God says to me that I will never be forsaken and I will never beg bread. When I used to be all self-conscious about how I looked and I always thought that I wasn't good enough, the law says, well, you aren't good enough and you will never be good enough. But now Jesus says that I am fearfully and wonderfully made, made just a little bit lower than the angels, and there will never be anyone created like me, and there will never be anyone created like me again. I am unique. When I felt attacked, I felt alone, and I sought comfort in the law, I said, law, they're coming at me from all different directions. The law says, well, you are alone because I'm not on your side. But God has assured me that no weapon formed against me will prosper. God says it doesn't matter if 10,000 people are surround you, that I have victory and I have it right now before the battle even begins. When I wanted to achieve heaven, the law says because of your sin, you are destined to hell. But God so loved me that he sent Jesus to live for me, Jesus to die for me. Jesus has now gone to prepare a place for me. And guess what? He's coming back for me, and he's coming back for you too. Divorced from the law and now married to Jesus. So I'm free right now. I'm free to serve, to love. I don't worry about damnation. I don't worry about being separated from God. I have peace that was not possible with the law. I have protection that was not possible with the law. I have assurance that was not possible by the law. I have hope that was not possible by the law. And I have a praise on my heart right now that was not possible when I was married to the law. And Paul is saying, brothers, this is what you've received. So now walk in it, serve in it, live in it, show others how they can be released from the law and receive it like you have. This is too good to keep to ourselves. And it's time to not only realize what we've been saved from, but what we've been saved to do. Let the light of freedom from the law shine. We have divorced the law. Now we can live in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. God bless you this morning. And I want to thank you for tuning in and worshiping with us. Your presence has been felt and very much appreciated. I want to remind you of our Zoom Bible studies and Sunday school. If you need information about the login, please hit me up at pastorportis@gmail.com. I want to give a special thanks to all who participated in our virtual congregational meeting on last Sunday. We had a great time. We had our first virtual installation and ordination service of elders and deacons. So thank you to all who you should have received your end of the year giving statements by now. And if you've not received them, please email me at pastorportis@gmail.com and I can get it to you. The work of this ministry continues. Whether we're in person or not, the work of this ministry in the community, and we continue to need you to be sacrificial in your giving. So please continue to look at your finances and make sure that you're giving with all of your heart. Thank you for allowing me to be your pastor. Thank you for allowing my wife and I to lead you as we are following God. We miss you. We love you. We're praying for you and hoping that you are praying for us. God bless you. We're going to end this worship service in song.
The blackness. Keep on.